This rack is actually the Everything Philly Muffin, which is definitely our best seller. Everything seeds, garlic, onion, poppy, and sesame. This is pretty much my baby. When it comes out well, I'm very happy. Perfect breakfast. 8 years in, I still eat more or less a muffin a day. It's the only way to start a day.
We have vents, you know, that vent out of an exhaust, and people just kind of like wander around until they find an entrance and like come in like, you guys sell bread? Yeah, I don't think every food does that, but bread does.
Merzbacher's is a wholesale artisan bread bakery. We'll make like maybe 10 to 12,000 pounds of dough every week. I'm pretty much at the bakery almost all day, every day. The baking starts at like 4:35 in the morning. Most of my day-to-day is like just support, jumping in on a delivery, helping out in the production shift. On a busy day, we might do like 100 deliveries or so. As you grow, you kind of hold on to some of your own customers, like the people who have been with you for 6, 7 years and you have a personal relationship with them. Does it make sense for the owner to like hop in his car and drive across town to deliver 2 dozen buns? Maybe not, but they're my friend and they'll probably give me a free sandwich, share some bread. Next up, we are heading to Friswit to drop off the gold rolls. Friswit is Ari Miller's version of a classic Philly cheesesteak.
Good morning.
Sweet. Got the rolls. Ari was like, I'm gonna take it upon myself to obsess over a cheesesteak. I'm gonna find the best roll. I'm gonna find the best cheese. When Ari tells you that he wants a cheesesteak roll like this, like he has thought about it. He has tasted every cheesesteak roll out there and he knows what he wants.
My favorite thing about Pete's bread is that it hits all the notes that I need it to hit. The bread does what it's supposed to do, and it does it deliciously so. Like, this cheesesteak doesn't really work without this roll. And a hoagie roll has to have a chew on the outside, and it has to be fluffy on the inside. The structure of the chew of this roll is really what, like, holds it all together. And then the inside is what soaks up all of that, like, meat juice. You need a roll that's gonna, like, be a sponge and then also be a container. And it does that with a lot of flavor.
The roll needs to be part of like a composition. I kind of like being a little bit behind the scenes. The cheesesteak was great for a lot of reasons. The roll was really good.
The idea with this sandwich is really like to give some honor and integrity to a sandwich that's like the definition of Philadelphia. It's not fancy, it's greasy. There's other great rolls in the sense of like, they do the job it's supposed to do, but they're not made in the same way. They're not made with the same level of like care and integrity and ingredient that this roll is. So this is 6 Friswit.
Here we have probably about 150 pounds of toasted cornmeal. And that is one of the things that give our gold roll just like a very subtle but noticeable kind of flavor. It's almost like the flavor of the crust ends up in the dough, almost. You know, like when you pull a baguette out of the oven, some people say it has like a popcorn-y kind of smell. Well, that's like now in the dough. Yeah, on any given week, we go through about 6,500 to 8,000 pounds of flour. So the gold roll formula is, it's basically flour, water, salt, yeast. I added a little bit of malted barley flour to it, but that's pretty much it. That's fermented, it's called, it's spelled poulish. But it's pronounced like a poulish. Like baguettes taste different than pancake batter because it's got pre-fermented white flour in it. So this is like the secret, not so secret anymore. It's the toasted cornmeal. I've been like a dishwasher, a line cook, a farmer. So I started making sourdough bread at home. Instantaneously, it was more than a hobby. Like I touched the dough and it was just like a click kind of a moment. People make fun of me, but I'm always kind of like squatting here and looking at it just to observe and see if it's getting overmixed or if it's mixing well. I had no experience in bread before I started the company, which was pretty stupid. So I wouldn't say I'm a very scientific person, but I am a very curious person. So anytime something went well, I would learn from it and I would try to perfect it and get it better. So I've just messed up hundreds of batches of dough, honestly, to start to kind of like figure it out. So you can kind of see it's got like an elastic and extensible quality. So as I'm pulling, it's kind of pulling me back in. It's like snapping back. That's a good thing. But I'm also able to kind of pull it and get like a more
kind of extensible quality. And then I just give it a fold to make it more cohesive. Dough baby, little chubby dough baby. Developing means you are helping the gluten form a network, and that network will help trap the gas that is produced during the fermentation process. This will sit for about an hour and a half. The business of running an artisan bread bakery is coming up with new products, engaging your appetite and curiosity, but also asking yourself, like, how can I make this artisan craft consistent? You know, that is the name of the game in bread, especially wholesale bread, putting out a great product consistently every single day. So I have a 13-ish pound cut of dough in this hydraulic dough divider here. So these are the gold rolls. They're about 17 inches in length, designed to be cut in half for a hoagie cheesesteak. I'm gonna put it through the deck oven now. Things are just gonna change so regularly in a bakery. The temperature, the size of the mix, the composition of that day, like you never can get it down to a perfect science. You have to kind of like touch the dough and ask yourself, how does the dough feel? Outside of that dough, all the like the environmental factors, those are always changing. So to get it to feel the same when everything else is different, that's really the hard part. The bread game is all about consistency. I mean, like, quality matters a lot, but people would rather like solid bread that is the same every day than bread that is sometimes like gourmet and perfect and other days really inconsistent. So gotta make sure everything is just right. I talk to the restaurants. If it's the wrong size, they'll call me personally and let me know. So we have visual standards that kind of document. So if I take off the gold roll, but I'm right there. So it's perfect size. Bread to Share is like an ethos for sure of the company. Like, bread is a vehicle for transporting like condiments and protein into your mouth, but it's also like a tool for bringing people together. You know, like, let's break bread. I very much enjoy getting a call from Ari and him being like, the bread's not quite right today. Ari cares and he wants to delight his customer and I want to delight him. And I go back and I tweak it and make it better. So I'm gonna steam it for 6 seconds, set a timer for 9. And by putting the steam in there, it can kind of expand without cracking. And simultaneously, that steam is like gelatinizing the dough a little bit. And then once you pull the damper and the steam escapes, it becomes a crusty hoagie roll. Check on them, and oh yeah, those are perfect. So you're just wondering kind of how I know they're done. They have the right color, kind of pale where it burst, but like a little bit of darker caramelization where the ear opened up, and then it just kind of sounds hollow and cooked out. Roughly speaking, like pretty much uniform from end to end. Very good, very good. Small delivery today.
Okay.
We have 6 of the original muffins, 4 of the multigrain. Pre-pandemic, our business was based on restaurant sales. Maybe 75%, 80% of our business was restaurants. Now it's closer to 50-50, restaurants and grocers. We're in the bread aisle, and what's interesting about finding Merzbacher's here is it's surrounded by national brands, conventional breads that nobody would really describe as being artisan. But Giant really took a chance on us and put us in this aisle. And what I'm trying to do is make a great product accessible to more people, whether you live in Philly or in the suburbs. And Merzbacher's has like the volume and the scale to kind of keep up with box stores like this. Obviously, in the beginning of the pandemic, there was a lot of panic buying, and everyone would just rush the stores and clear out all their bread. So they would get cleared out, and they would call all their vendors, like, we need more bread, we need more bread. Interestingly, the more corporate bakeries were not very well equipped to keep up with the demand in the first couple weeks. We were ready, and we had all this capacity and flour, so we really got our foot in the door, and they started to see Merzbachers as, like, the reliable sure bet. Yeah, I used to deliver those muffins on a bicycle, actually. And then once I graduated from the bicycle, I moved on to Zipcar, and then delivered all my bread on Zipcar. Now I have a truck and a team and a number of giant supermarkets, so pretty crazy. Here are sweet potato for the sweet potato bun. And what we're gonna do is stick them in the oven. Like, potato doughs are often kind of soft and tender. It's like a natural sweetener, so it gives the bun kind of like a subtle sweetness. I mean, you can just see how much, like, syrup is in there, and like all the little caramelized bits there, like that is all great flavor. Almost all the ideas that I have are kind of me asking myself what I want. You figure out all the logistical stuff later, but I think you start with a question like, what is the burger bun that I want to eat? And then you start tinkering. At the end of every mix, you want to take a temp of the dough. Dough is, like, at its core, a balance of, like, time and temperature. And so if it's too cold, it'll take too long to bulk ferment. If it's too warm, it will ferment too quickly. Like, microorganisms will just be stressed out. The heat really kind of angers them. So if it's, like, 100 degrees or more, it'll start, like, burping out off flavors. Now it's just one kind of continuous network of gluten. So this dough has gone through the bulk fermentation. It's the sweet potato dough. So we mixed it, we let it rise for a couple hours, and now we're cutting it into a pre-shape. So the next step after these get divided is to run them through the divider rounder. Blades will come through and divide it into 24 equally weighted pieces, and then the bottom platform kind of shimmies and gyrates and kind of mimics, like, me having 24 hands and rounding it really quickly. So this machine that I'm using here is called a divider rounder, and it does exactly that. It divides it, rounds it, and you have more or less two dozen perfect buns. And here are the sweet potato buns. When I created Merzbacher's, I really wanted, like, the logo and the whole ethos to be like, that's a bakery I can trust. It looks like they've been around for a long time. They look trustworthy. They have, like, an element of surprise and good energy, but, like, at its core, it's a bread bakery. They're making stuff that I can, like, enjoy any day of the week with anyone, and you don't have to be like a guru to enjoy it. I've been doing it for 7-8 years now, and so there were people, I'm sure, who had their first Philly muffin when they were 10 years old, and they're now, you know, nearly an adult. If I asked you, like, what your first, like, real bread memory was, that moment when you realized how good bread could be. I remember making pretzels with my dad when I was a very young kid. And do I remember, like, the recipe? No. But do I remember, like, the joy of, like, doing something with my family? Yes, very much so. Do I remember, like, eating pizza and watching a movie with my family? Very much so. But I haven't gotten sick of bread yet. I go home smelling like it. My car smells like it. My bakery smells like it. Like, my shoes are covered in flour. Like, bread is with me all the time. And I'm pretty cool with that.